So now comes our attorneys, two attorneys, Michael Lee from RUR Attorney, and also Xiaowei Li from RUR Attorneys too. Okay, so I saw Michael show up. How about Xiaowei Li?
Yes.
You're here. Okay, thank you.
Greetings.
Hey, thank you. So yes. Before we start, let me introduce Michael and Xiaowei a little bit. Michael is the partner and co-founder of IR Attorneys, a premier Bay Area law firm, professor at Santa Clara University School of Law, executive extensive experience in international estate planning and business succession, representative clients include multinational companies, company directors and officers, persons of multinationality, tax obligation and fiduciaries. And Xiaowei Li, partner and co-founder of IR Attorney, unique bilingual and bicultural familiarity that recognizes not only the legal differences among systems, but also varying cultural values and expectations of estate planning. Current practice focused on estate and tax planning, estate and guardianship, planning for international families, estate and gift of non-residents alien U.S. domestic assets, family wealth preservance, and asset protection. Welcome you too.
Thank you, Catherine.
Okay, I know you prepared your
presentation. I'm sharing my screen.
Yeah, I'm sure that you would talk about something about the proper 19, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Can you see my screen now?
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Okay. Uh-huh. Great. Okay, thank you, Catherine, for inviting us. My name is Xiaowei Li, and I'm an attorney from RUI Attorneys. Today, my partner, Michael Li, and I will give everyone updates on estate planning and asset protection. Michael, do you want to introduce about the topic and yourself first?
Yes, so I'm very excited to be here, and thank you, Catherine. We've had a really wonderful group. I was really interested in seeing the information from all of the various county assessors. This has been a challenging time for all of us. Actually, you know, of course, we're dealing with the COVID pandemic. We're dealing with an election. And of course, we're dealing with a number of changes in law. And all of these things are happening at once. And there's the of course, the Prop 19 issues causing a lot of analysis to be done on whether property should be transferred, property shouldn't be transferred. And then for those properties there that we should transfer, it is causing a lot of work. And you know, there we've had experience using the e-recording generally has been good. It's sometimes not as you know, easy as it is for, let's say, title companies, but it's out there. And then also for on the other estate planning side, which I think Xiaowei and I will be talking about first, for just general estate planning, we've really seen a lot of estate plans and, you know, so family succession planning, business succession planning being stress tested, sadly, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, of having to look at your plans and starting to feel that it's not so academic. We actually have to really go through now and see, are your trustees local? Are they able to do the job? Are the power of attorney agents, are they local? Are they able to do the job? Guardians for children. You know, I've had some people where the guardian name for children is out of state. I've had some where they're out of the country, and their estate plan says, "Oh, my, you know, mother, you know, in China is going to be the guardian of the children." As of now, it's a little bit better. But about 6 months ago, there's no possible way this person could ever enter the United States. So we're starting to see the stress testing of plans, and there's a lot of work and consideration for California families to start looking at their plans and looking at their property and figuring out, how do I optimize this for safety, security, and their tax efficiency?
Yes. Before we talk more about the COVID-19 and the state planning. I think some audience may not be familiar with the state planning. Can you give a brief introduction of the reason why everyone in California need a state planning, what the purpose of a state planning is?
Everyone in California needs estate planning. I'd say everyone in the country and even you know, throughout the world in the various legal systems need this. Really what estate planning is creating a design and creating the legal structure for the situation where either one passes away or one is incapacitated. One cannot express his or her preferences. So this is the classic, what you may have heard of the will, trust, power of attorney, healthcare directive, these sort of four critical documents working together so that we achieve the objectives that Xiaowei has listed here to avoid conservatorship, to avoid probate, to preserve family wealth, to streamline distribution, and to take care of special needs, sometimes classic special needs, someone has a disability, or to take care of unique circumstances. People have varying circumstances of their international people. There are any number of issues that could come up. That's what we're trying to do with estate planning.
Okay. Can you give a specific example of the purpose of estate planning, like when you practice an example, really emphasize the importance of estate planning?
I have a great one on this one. Probably one of the saddest and most difficult cases that I have had. Basically, this was years ago. A client contacts me, says, I'm really concerned my mother, an elder abuser, I think, has gotten a hold of my mother. It's the person who's doing like kind of the gardening stuff around the house, and now has my mother claims she's fallen in love with him. And I say, well, okay, why do you think she may not have capacity? And she said, the client woman says, well, my mother's 93, and it's hard to say she has dementia, but she's 93, and she's a little bit off. And the gardener is like 30. So I think, there's probably a problem here. We say, maybe we should do conservatorship. We should, have the court take some control for the mother. Again, this is very unpleasant because we have to seek the court to take control of her mother. My client, interestingly enough, all of a sudden, I don't hear from my client for a number of days. And interestingly enough, my client was premier physician at UCLA Medical School. So she was a professor of medicine at UCLA Medical School. All of a sudden, I don't hear from her for several weeks. I get a panicked call about 3-4 weeks later from her sister and says, Mr. Lee, my sister was contacting you. She has passed away. She has died. The doctor at UCLA, she was unmarried. She's died. She said, the elder abuser has my mom in the car and they are driving to Los Angeles to take control of my sister's estate. In it. So not only did this guy try to steal the mom's estate, he's then trying to steal the dead daughter's estate, both at the same time. And again, the key problems with both of these, neither mother or daughter had an estate plan. So mother didn't have a trust. There was no way to protect her assets from the elder abuser or to deal with things like that. Daughter, same thing. She didn't have an estate plan. And for unmarried persons with no children, your first priority heir are your parents. So by operation of general law, actually the elder abuser via the mother was the first priority heir. And this was a shocking thing as I remember it vividly because we were literally writing the petition in the car. It was so urgent. The sister was driving and I was typing as we drove down the five because we had to file and we were literally in line at the Stanley Moss Courthouse in Los Angeles to file competing probate petitions at the same time on this estate because it was so dire. And this is kind of this is an extreme example, but what the point is that the point of estate planning is that your estate is predictable and you thought it through and you thought, well, who do I want to protect me? Who do I want to take care of me? And how do I make this tax efficient? And you do it intelligently by thinking it through rather than crossing your fingers and hoping that the law default is what you want and hoping that the law default matches the tax efficiency. As the assessors said very clearly, maybe your intent is not exactly the way the law naturally works. Maybe you need to do a transfer now, maybe not. Maybe you need to make some arrangement. And that's what we mean by planning. We have to go through the analysis. We have to think it through.
Yes, I remember that example as well. This is a good lesson to learn for a lot of people. I know you just mentioned that COVID has run a stress test to the estate plans. Can you give some specific examples, like how does COVID impact estate planning and design in your practice?
I think a couple of things have been very noticeable. One is we really have to start thinking, clients really need to start thinking about successor trustees, successor powers of attorney, successor executors. Your first choice person may not be easily able to discharge that duty due to travel restrictions, due to stresses of their own job. I have a lot of people, again, like that example, is that the perfect client for to be the conservator, professor of medicine would be a perfect person. She had, of course she passed away, but let's say she didn't, she has no time to administer an estate now during a pandemic. If you're a professor of medicine right now, you're probably working 24 hours a day. Do you have a successor? We have to start thinking about that. I see this a lot with people who have multi-state or international families, that they're relying on people. They say, oh, my brother in New York will do it. It's going to be real hard for him to do it. We have to start thinking about things like that. A lot of people, the second thing is the advanced healthcare directive. A lot of people just say, Bill's my agent and whatever my end of life planning is, I tick the box. You may want to think about that more carefully now. Think about, again, your range of healthcare agents. Think about the kind of care that you want. I'd recommend taking a look at that. Also, I take a look, especially international families. I had this with a couple of persons in China. They were trying to close a real estate transaction here. They were trying to sell a property. Luckily, we had done their estate planning. This was a kind of a lucky example. The client contacted us and she said, I really need to sell this particular house. I'm here, but my husband's not here. He's in China. And there's, China's locked down right now. He can't come here to sign. And then we gave the standard answer. We said, well, go to the consulate. She said, no. Their buildings are locked down. He can't leave his apartment. He's not leaving, getting out the door. What do we do? And I said, well, you do have the estate plan, right? She says, yeah. I said, go look at the power of attorney. Your husband granted you immediate power of attorney, right? For the estate plan. She said, yes. I said, send it to the title company. Title company said, boom, power of attorney, close tomorrow. Perfect. That's estate planning to live. That's estate planning where your plan in that binder of will, trust, power of attorney, healthcare directive, it solves real day-to-day problems. That was a great example. I was so happy for the client because this was such a problem that all of a sudden we say, that estate plan we drafted for you, solutions in the binder. That's what we want to start thinking of with good COVID 19 planning and estate planning is I want solution. I want more and more solutions in that binder. And what has been the challenge though, COVID has made the problems more complicated.
Yes, I remember when COVID first happened in China, actually all the US consulates and the US embassy actually, they were closed. So our clients couldn't get their documents notarized, even though they hire us to draft the documents, their documents couldn't be notarized. And they are not effective if they are notarized.
And many of the consulates were slow to reopen, as you remember, is that many of the smaller consulates in the smaller city, small is relative, but in not the top cities, in Changsha or Chengdu, the consular officials were withdrawn for several months. So there actually was nobody to notarize these documents unless you went to Beijing or Shanghai. So it took a long time for that process to restart itself. So again, estate planning to live, you want to look at things like how can your estate plan not only make sure your affairs are taken care of for illness and death, but what about day-to-day wellness? Thinking about that is very important too. Yeah. And people keep forgetting about this of the number one on your chart, people around you. What about your parents? What about your brothers and sisters, especially if they're single? I have so many people say, my parents don't have anything. In fact, they gave me the house already for this problem. They don't have anything. They don't need an estate plan. They don't need anything. I say, well, What about their medical? What about the power of attorney? Do you have the HIPAA and SEMA authorization so that you can go talk to your talk to their doctor? I said, no, my mom and dad are fine. I said, now they're fine. What if they're not? It's a 4-page piece of paper. You know, let's just do the 4-page piece of paper so that if you need to talk to their doctor, they can grant you the authority to speak to their doctor. You know, think these things are you know, of really high importance, again, especially now with COVID, because there's so many times, like, I've had clients, this is another real example. The hospital is doing like Zoom exams. They're doing check-ins with their patients on Zoom. And the, you know, needless to say, I have many clients that have older parents. Older parents are not good on Zoom. And then there's this big problem of that they need their children to set up the Zoom and do all these things, but then the doctor doesn't want to converse if the non-patient is there without an authorization. So it's just very hard to get these things set up. So again, you're doing this for parents and family can really save a lot of time and challenge.
Okay, great. We just talk about estate planning and the COVID and the estate planning, the new changes. And now let's move on to the California law changes. We know in 2020, there are many laws passed in California. And Michael, which one is your favorite?
Well, I do have a favorite. Actually, maybe we could pop to the slide here. California legislature did something that I think is very helpful for California families, is that we have increased the California homestead exemption. So we used to be famous in the United States in California of having among the worst homestead exemptions in the country. What is the homestead exemption? In California law, in the law of every state, there is a list of property. They're called the exemptions. And for us, it's California Civil Code 703 and 704, or California Code of Civil Procedure, pardon me. It's the CCP, Code of Civil Procedure 703, 704. 704 is the one you want to look at. 703 is only if you file bankruptcy. So we're looking at 704. And this is basically a list of property that creditors cannot take away from you. You know, MasterCard, Discover Card, or if somebody sues me, something that even if I lose the lawsuit, they can't take these things away from me. And the traditional one for home equity was, if you were a single person, $75,000, married couple or person with a dependent, $100,000, or over 65, $175,000. I don't know where you all live, but as you know, let's say if I'm a single person, I don't know where I can get a $75,000 house. if you let me know where you can get a $75,000 house, let's go and buy a few. There's no such thing. Really anywhere in California. I grew up outside of rural Barstow. This is far southeastern California. I can tell you, rural Barstow, you still can't get a house for $75,000. It's just too low. We finally increased this to an amount of money that actually provides some protection. So now it's basically going to be the median home price of each county that will be checked, you know, every year, looking backwards. So the homestead will be no less than $300,000 and no more than $600,000 in the major counties. You know, of course, you have Alameda, Santa Clara, San Mateo. The median price is far over $600,000. So the exemption will be $600,000. So what this means is that you now have an amount of primary residence home equity that cannot be touched by creditors. That is really good. Just remember, you only have one, and it only applies to your primary residence, your homestead. But now some asset protection planning can be very useful in taking a look and saying, well, how much home equity do I have? Maybe I want to structure some home equity planning so I don't have more than $600,000. Maybe I want to have a first deed of trust and then have a second, and then I can draw on the second if I have some trouble. And then, you know, also reading, you know, CCP, you know, section 704, thinking, you know, are my other assets in a way that are safe, or do I have things exposed? You know, keeping a lot of cash in a bank account, very, very exposed to creditors. Maybe I want to put a little bit of that into my home for my homestead, and then maybe I want to put it into a couple of other things that's more safe. So California, I think they did a good job on this, protecting, you know, homeowners, protecting people's home equity from creditors in a time that's very difficult. So I think they did well on this. So I like this change.
Great, great. And for people who are interested in knowing more about homestead exemptions, you, feel free to contact us. And I will leave our information at the end of our PowerPoint, and we can give you more information about this exemption, because this is a pretty major change in the laws.
Pretty major change. And it basically, like, if you considered asset protection planning, and a lot of people, when they talk about asset protection, they say, well, I want to take care of my home. A lot of attorneys said, well, you have to do something very complicated and very fancy and very risky to do this. Nowadays, you don't really have to. The California said, no, we're going to support you. We're going to back you up on your home. We're going to protect that, which California never used to do. California used to say, if you get into trouble, you lose your house. And we'll give you 70, you get $75,000 and, you know, God help you. You know, nowadays we say, no, we don't want people being thrown out of their homes. We don't want people losing their home equity. So with that being the law, we can then make sure that we plan to protect the home and protect other assets. I frequently see clients holding assets in ways that are very, very risky, and they could just do a little bit of asset protection, financial adjustment. That would be very, very safe, and very legally safe, tax efficient. That would be much better than sometimes, you know, you have these, you know, $300,000 in cash in a bank account, which is over the FDIC limit. It's even the bank will often sometimes tell you or make you sign a warning and say, you know, after the first 250, sometimes we can't insure this with the FDIC, you know, things that are not, you know, super safe. So
yes, and it also is very important for people to understand what fraudulent transfer is and to avoid fraudulent transfer. We see that a lot in our consultation with clients.
And that's the thing, is use the law as it's designed and don't try to do fraudulent, you know, California calls them voidable transfers, but they're called fraudulent transfers, where someone gets into trouble and then someone tries to transfer something to a brother or sister or convert non-exempt property to exempt property. And that's a fraudulent transfer that can be undone. Don't go down that path of doing things, you know, crookedly. Just do it right and do it transparently and do it legally, and you'll be in fine shape, because the law this year, or I should say, you know, 2020, California was trying to help you. You know, they were trying to say, you know what, we care about this. We want to protect people. It's been a hard year. And it's been after, you know, almost 100 years of having a really bad system on this, we finally fixed it.
Okay, great. Okay, now let's move on to Prop 19, the famous Prop 19, yes, which has been discussed a lot by different groups of people. So Michael, from your consultation with clients, do you recommend people to do an emergency Prop 19 transfer to protect their property tax basis?
I would say this. I recommend people to do an intelligent analysis of Prop 19 and their properties. I think what basically people need to do is take out a list and write out their properties, determine their tax assessments, you know, determine where they are on the basis, determine their family structure, and then think about whether or not to transfer this. You know, great information from all of the assessors that really gave us, you know, the in-depth answer for a lot of things. But then, just like the assessors and just like me as, you know, the lonely lawyer here, a lot of this is we don't know. This was not designed. Prop 19 was not designed by the legislature. It was not designed by the board of the BOE. It was not designed by the assessors. So all of us, you know, BOE assessors, don't blame us. It was passed, you know, as a proposition. So it was passed, you know, quickly, with a quick effective date. So we don't have a lot of guidance, where often if this is passed by the legislature, they give a year or so before it's effective. The BOE, you know, analyzes this, it comes out with guidance, so we know what we're talking about. This went through on the ballot, and everybody, you know, has to live with it. So the first thing that I say, what should I do? You have to analyze this in a multi-factor analysis. So I've had 50, 100 people. I mean, after Prop 19 passed, I mean, you get calls every single day on Prop 19. And I'm finding about half the time we say transfer and half the time we say don't, because there's a plus and a minus to each thing that you do. What you have to think about, you know, number one, you have to think about is, do I want to use the old system, the Prop 58, to transfer the property? Is there actually a major difference between where I'm assessed now to, you know, the future fair market value where it will be assessed later? First, we have to see that. If you just bought the property and it's, you know, depending on the market and things that you say, well, it may not really be, you know, that much more valuable in the far future, maybe you fail test number one. Second thing, do remember that for income tax, or once you change the title of the property to the child, they become the owner and the income tax attributes flow to that person. So the first thing that flows to that person is it's called carryover basis. The income tax basis, federal income tax basis, also carries over to that person. So if, let's say, you know, you had an old retired mom and dad, and then you have the you know, Google engineer who has a, you know, $800,000 salary, you've placed the property to someone who has very, very high capital gains tax exposure. You know, they'll be paying the top rate, you know, and they already pay a lot of taxes. You also may have caused a situation, if it's going to be a rental for them, where they are not subject to the Section 121 exclusion. It's not their primary residence. Mom and dad may have been living there, and then you gave it to them. If they sell it, it's all exposed to capital gains tax. There's no $250 per person, you know, like mom and dad. $500,000 is exempt from capital gains, federal income tax capital gains. But when you transfer it to the son who doesn't live there, you just destroyed that, because then he's the seller and the capital gains go to him. Same thing as the rents. Let's say same story, that it wasn't a primary residence, it's rented. The high net worth guy is now getting the rents. The rents are going to be taxed much higher. So, you know, you have to calculate, well, how much do I pay tax on the rents versus how much do I pay for the assessment? And just like, you know, Mr. Law, you know, said, you got to calculate it, because you may take a look at this and say, yes, I save, you know, $1,200 a year, or, you know, $4,000 a year on property tax. I win. And then you see your CPA and they calculate the tax on the rents. And you say, wait, I have to pay how much? 38% of the rents for the year I have to pay in income tax? I don't think you won in that transaction. I think that was a loser. You didn't calculate it. The other thing you have to take a look at is the estate gift transfer. High net worth persons, if you are a high net worth person, you do have to file, well, anyone who transfers a property gratuitously is required to file a gift tax return. It's just in the Internal Revenue Code. But for high net worth persons, it does draw down your lifetime exemption. Your lifetime exemption now, a lot of people say, oh, I don't care about that. It's $11 million. It is until 2025, December 31st. Then it goes back down to five. And the ordering rule from the IRS is that we do not calculate off the top. We calculate from the bottom up. So if you gift a $2 million property, it's not like you have 11 and we take out two and you have nine left. We say you took from the bottom and we say, okay, there was 11. You took out two from the bottom. It dropped down to five, but because you already took two from the bottom, you only have three left. So be careful. It's not the way that it first appears, because the IRS, again, is called an ordering rule. Basically, the IRS gave in the regulations the calculation for how you do it. And the calculation pencils out differently than most people think. So you have to be careful. So things for, like, you know, I think, you know, everybody listening says, well, okay, well, Mike, what should I do? Really what you want to, you know, ones that may be potentially appropriate to transfer would be second properties, things like rentals. You know, depending on the value, those may be appropriate to transfer under the right circumstances. You know, that can be important. Because if you consider secondary properties, because the Prop 58 will be, the part for second properties will be eliminated, you may want to do that. You may want to consider parents' properties, that if you're not going to live there, Maybe your parents transfer it early, but then just think about that first example. If you say, well, they'll transfer the property to me and then maybe I'll keep it a year or two or sell it. Just think about wait, if I destroyed the Section 121 exemption and I'm paying capital gains tax on 500 grand that I wouldn't have had to, that my parents wouldn't have had to pay. Again, maybe this is clever like a fox, stupid like a fox, where you avoid one thing and then you back into a far higher tax. I'm a little bit nervous seeing a lot of these Prop 19 transfers happening. And because again, I'm getting a lot of calls on these things and I'm getting really nervous of people are not seeing the other aspect. They're looking just at this property tax thing. And they're saying, I saved $1,200 on the property tax. But if you blow the Section 121 exemption and you have to pay 20% of $500,000, how did you possibly win in that transaction? That makes no sense because so you're paying 20% of $500,000 is $100,000. How did the property tax hold, calculate it? The property tax holding period would have to be quite long for your losing the $100,000 to make sense. So I'm seeing this all the time where I'm thinking, the client is dead set that they say, I'll save so much of property tax. I said, but wait, do you want to keep the property long-term or do you want to sell it? They say, I'm on the fence, maybe sell it in a couple of years. It's like, well, you really have to think about that because it plays into the transaction. If you're going to sell soon, you got to think of it's an income tax play. If you're going to keep a long time, it's a property tax play. So you have to, it's like football. You have to know the play that you're going to do before you run it. Because otherwise, I've seen a lot of people, the quarterback's got the ball. He's like, I'm just going to throw it anywhere. And, I think that's the problem. So I caution people with Prop 19 is talk to us and talk to your professionals, because it's not a one-dimensional thing. It's a multi-dimensional thought. And my biggest concern is people will say, I'm in a mad dash rush because I just heard Mr. Law and Mr. Leong say, I've got to get the deed in, I've got to get it recorded. I'm gonna, I gotta get this thing across the counter to the recorder. And that's true, you do, you have to get it across the counter in time, but do it after thinking it through. Because I am certain I'm going to have clients in the summer that do it. Probably not the summer. I bet I'm probably going to get them next year at about this time, is they're going to talk to their accountant. So they recorded the deed, they start to do this, and they talk to the accountant, and the accountant starts to run the income tax next year, and they're going to get a bad result, and they're going to call me, and they're going to say, Mike, how do I undo the Prop 19 transfer? It's killing me in income tax. I'm going to say, that's why you should have taken a look at it last year, because now you've already transferred it. You're going to transfer it again. That's going to cause a reassessment. You're going to be stuck with that 1 year of income tax. You're going to have a lot of mess. So my strong recommendation is and this is the thing, there's a lot of people out there for these Prop 19 things that say, oh, we'll do the deed and we'll do the paperwork for $250 or $500, and you bring it down to the recorder or all this stuff. And I say, did they go through the analysis of this with you, with the income tax, the 121 exemption, all these things? Because if they didn't look at that, you may be blindsided. My classic one is that 121 exemption, and people are going to be blindsided that they owe capital gains.
The key thing is to consult with your attorney, your professionals before you make the transfer to avoid any problems in the future. Okay, yep. Michael, the last topic we're going to discuss today is about the Fed law changes. I know you have a lot of high net worth individual clients, and do you have any planning techniques or insights about estate tax changes to this kind of clients?
Yes, and this is the thing that keeps me up at night. Much as Prop 19 keeps me up at night.
Sorry, before you talk about it, just to clarify, the reason I ask about the federal law changes in estate tax is because in California, we do not have state estate tax. So in California, the major estate tax we need to deal with is the federal law.
Yeah, Yeah, people in Oregon, Washington State, Minnesota, if you have friends and family out in some of those states, they have a state tax you have to take a look at. But California, we don't. So we're looking at the federal. This slide actually is the old slide. My prediction was likely not much happening here. I've changed my mind. I've changed my mind because the Republican Party lost two Senate seats in Georgia. Total loss. And it is now, when they seat the new Congress, it is going to be 50 blue and 50 red. And we all took US government, right? Who cast the tie-breaking vote when it's 50-50? The vice president, who is our senator or was our senator, Kamala Harris. So in the prior slide, and this was last year before the special election, I thought not much is going to be happening with the estate tax. I am somewhat concerned that it could be included in a big tax reform package. And if it is in a big tax reform package, there may be adjustments. On the other hand, there is a lot going on right now. It's been very hard for Congress to even pass the COVID relief bills, which are desperately needed and very, they need to be cleaned up, but there's, something needs to be done there. I don't think the estate tax is, why Kamala Harris went to Washington. I think she has bigger things to do, but it may be in there. So basically, what I'm saying for my clients for the estate tax is assume, we're definitely going down to 5 million in 2025, but assume we may be going down earlier. So we need to start thinking about irrevocable trust planning, gifting to irrevocable trusts, and doing gifts under there are techniques called the Wandry rules or the McCord rules. You don't need to know what these are, but there are ways to make gifts where you say, my gift to my irrevocable trust is, $3 million or whatever, contingent upon the law being $3 million at the year closing of the year of the gift. That's often the Wandry clause. So again, if you're doing gifting or moving things around, especially like with the Prop 19, make sure you're doing it with a skilled lawyer, because if we have something that happens, which this would be the scariest thing, that Congress says we're going to lower the estate tax exemption to $3.5 million effective year 2021. I say, wait a minute. In February, I gifted more than that. I thought the law was 11 million. And Congress says, no, it's 3.5. And you say, look, how could you do that? You passed the law in the year and made it effective in the year retroactively. You can't do that. They can, unless it's a wholly new tax. The Supreme Court has said they can adjust rates and they can adjust basically the schedules of exemptions, unless they're creating like a totally new taxing system. They do this. Anyone who trades stock a lot has dealt with this with the capital gains tax. Sometimes the capital gains tax is changed effective the year it's proposed. And your transactions from earlier in the year you thought would be taxed at a 15% rate are taxed at a 20% rate, even though that law passed after the transaction, that it was effective for that year. Happens a lot. I doubt that will happen, but if it does, you have to be drafting with Wandry clauses, McCord clauses, so that as they change the law, your plan automatically acknowledges that and goes with the flow. And it's the sort of bend, the bamboo example. Bamboo is very strong, but it's very strong because it can bend and it can flex. If it's made out of glass and you put a little flex on there and it shatters, that's the problem. So that's what we're trying to do, is to have something strong but flexible. So that's the planning. So I think that's our introduction. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you very much, Catherine. It's really a privilege to be on with you. We have some great people for the assessor's office. Really a privilege to follow them. That's a great honor. So.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Catherine, for inviting us.
Okay, so Xiaowei, before you leave, so can you give me a quick answer to the question of what the Chinese translation to estate planning?
财产规划或者遗产规划。Actually, I just answered the question in the dialogue. Yeah. Okay. I just type the answer to the person who asked the question.
So it deserves to make your asset protected and also make it your assets inherited to the next generation very smoothly. So please do go for a professional like Xiaowei Li and Michael Li for any of the legal advice. Okay, yeah, thank you all. Thank you too for your legal presentation on asset protection and also the inheritance. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Our next session.